welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to yet another exciting episode of High Level Talk. In today's episode, or rather live stream, we are going to be talking to the infamous, or should I say famous, Chellah Tukuta, because there's a lot of things that we need to discuss and we need to get down to the bottom of everything. So welcome, Chellah. Welcome to this live stream. How are you doing, my brother? Hello, Chellah.
Yeah, hi.
Can you get me? How are you doing?
I'm very well. How are you?
I am perfect. Doing very well. It's good to have you here on the show. It's very good to have you.
Yeah, thank you very much. It's also good to be on this show. Yeah. It's finally, it's nice to be here.
Awesome. So, Chellah, today we have quite a lot of information to get down to. And we're mostly going to be talking about progressive stuff because obviously there are much more bigger issues that we need to be handling. So first of all, before we jump into all these amazing stuff, I just want to find out who exactly Chellah Tukuta is. Have you always been this vocal? Have you always had a background of either speaking out or just being on the limelight?
Chellah Tukuta is a Zambian, first of all. Okay, like any other Zambian. I'm Bemba and Mambwe. And, you know, I'm that person who's expressive. I express myself. I speak out, okay, and I've had the history of speaking out, even when I was in school, you know, when something went wrong, when something went bad, I spoke out, you know, and that's my history. So I've always spoken out, and I love to speak out because that's me, understand? Yeah, so I've always been vocal. It's just that some people just knew about me recently. Yeah, so otherwise, I've always been speaking out. Yeah, that's me.
All right, awesome. And where were you brought up? Were you brought up on the Copper Belt? Because personally, I come from Kitwe, and you know how Copper Belt people are in terms of just being expressive. So where exactly did you grow up?
I grew up, first of all, I was born in Chingola.
Ooh, okay.
Tasama, and I started my primary school at Kasenda Primary School in Tasama. Then I went back to the Copper Belt in Luansha, where I continued my education from elementary primary school in Luansha, and then later went to Luansha Boys. And from Luansha Boys, I went to Serenity Technical High School. Yeah.
Awesome. So, obviously, you have ruffled a few feathers, and a lot of people are not really that, you know, happy with you due to the fact that you have been very vocal. And right now, it seems you are spearheading this amazing movement where the Zambian youths are becoming to sort of become enlightened in terms of what's really happening with our governance and what's really happening like behind closed doors. So have you received any threats so far? Has your life been put in danger at all?
Yeah, what has happened, you know, is that there are people that have exposed, you know, they are going around, you know, using some cadres to call me and threaten me. But, you know, I know this politics that's there, you know, but at the end of the day, the country has to know the truth, you know, and information is important, and information helps people to vote wisely. Information helps people to make the right decisions and make the right choices. I just want, the reason why I've been coming out is to open my people's eyes, let people see what's happening, let people, you know, make informed decisions, you know. So that's what I've been doing basically. And I'm not scared of you know, of people coming to me and say, I'm suing you. I've not received any threats in terms of, no, I'm going to sue you. What? No. The people that I've spoken about on corruption and the evil things that they've been doing in this country, robbing our country, you know, millions and millions of dollars, they know that it's true. So that's why they've not even bothered to call me. They use people that are close to me, people that I know. Like recently, there's Amos Chanda sent some guy who is a friend of mine to say, no, tell Chellah to go to a lodge. So this guy starts telling me, Chellah, when you leave your house, tell me which lodge you'll go to. This, you know, start coming up with lies. But I know, you know, people are telling me, okay, these guys are planning this about you. These guys are planning this about you. And I mean, we are on point. We are watching everything. We are seeing everything. I saw the video where our president, you know, spoke things, and yeah, I'm watching. I'm seeing. Yeah,
exactly. And talking about that particular video that is obviously making rounds here on social media, what is your take as far as hearing our highest authority endorsing some of the actions that, you know, Honorable Bowman Lusambo was, you know, actually doing? So what's your take on the president's reaction or his words with regards to that particular situation?
To be honest with you, I didn't expect that from our leader, from our president. I expected our president to protect every citizen. And, you know, when you're a father, you need to protect every child. You need to hear both sides. Don't just listen to Bowman Lusambo. Listen to the other children. What is it that is happening? Don't just, you see, it's like a father who just hears, oh, this one was saying this about you, and immediately start weeping without listening to the other side of the story. I expected the president to just, you know, watch those videos, listen, and judge for himself. It was out of love. But to come out in that manner, in my opinion, has just opened a Pandora's box. And I'm glad that Zambians now have seen, and we all have seen to say, okay, so the reason why these guys behave like this, it's because they know they've got the support from there. And where does that leave me as a citizen?
You know? Exactly, exactly.
Yeah, in the end, I think to myself, I'm not safe in my own country. If my president can say that, if my president can direct the minister of local government, home affairs, and say, This. You could see that indirectly it was me and Biflo being talked about.
But, precisely.
But I'll be honest with every Zambian that's watching this video that for me personally, as Chellah Tukuta, I'm not surrendering. I'm not giving up. The truth can take you to prison. The truth will take you out of prison. You know, this thing of intimidating citizens, this thing of instilling fear in people, we are going to use it. Look, the instruments of power are there to protect the citizens. That's what they are there for. Because those instruments of power are given to any leader by the voters, by the people that vote. Okay? I'll give an example of leaders that have gone down in history, the likes of Omar Bashir. The moment Omar Bashir revolted, you know, the people, the army, the generals couldn't take it anymore, killing innocent lives. You know, a time always comes when you, even the police themselves, may just say, you know what, these are innocent citizens. After all, none of us insulted the president. None of us disrespected him. All that we are trying to air out where our views on what is affecting this country, what is affecting every youth. This thing is not about Chellah Tukuta, it's not about Biflo, it's not about what. This thing is about us crying, and, you know, for our own rights, you know, demanding our fair share, you know, in this nation. Why is it that opportunities have to be only for those who are cadres, for those who belong to a certain political party? We are all Zambians. You do not have to belong to a political party for you to enjoy the benefits of this country. At the end of the day, we are all Zambians. And what we are only demanding are answers and accountability. And the people that we have I named personally to say they are corrupt, they are corrupt. That's the more reason why I didn't even apologize, because I know they are corrupt. I know they've done things that are corrupt. So there is no diplomacy about, you know, being someone who's being corrupt. Look, I am of the view that in life, you are better off, you know, being ill-treated, subjected to all kinds of things because you have spoken the truth. Okay? Because cowardice, if we be coward today as youths, as young people of this country, what precedents are we setting for future generations? The future generations will come and think, okay, they'll think it's a norm. The same thing with the political scene. The thing is that people come to us, beg for votes, beg for us to campaign for them. We campaign with them, we suffer with them. The moment they attain office, they forget about us. Now, I personally, I do international works. I can sit down and say, look, after all, I make money from international gigs. I make money from whatever. But I'm thinking, we should stop thinking selfishly. That's a selfish thought. So I realized to myself, this is not about Chellah enjoying alone, or Chellah, you know, this. No. It's about those brothers and sisters who are always begging us. Is that the way it's supposed to be? Opportunities have to be equal for everybody. There has to be equality. There has to be fairness in everything. And for me, that's the whole point. Let us be fair.
Exactly. And just to add on that particular point that you raised, right? Right now, we are being approached as Zed Corner by a lot of, you know, Africans in the diaspora. So whatever move you have started making, just know that the people have your back. And this is actually way beyond Zambia. In case Bowman Lusambo is just thinking, okay, this guy, he's just, you know, like a citizen who's got no power. Trust me, there's a lot of, you know, African organizations. There's a lot of, you know, different groups of people who are trying to pitch in and just trying to see what's happening, because they are concerned about what's really happening in Zambia. So this is actually way deeper than it actually is. And I just want to let you know that the people have your back. Zambians have your back. Even Africans in the diaspora are closely watching on what's happening. So just like they say, injustice anywhere is injustice everywhere. Because if we let them silence you, right, that basically means every Zambian is being silenced. And Africans nowadays are not really going to let that happen, because we have seen that happen over and over and over again. So I just want to let you know that this is actually way deeper than it is. There's a lot of, you know, people outside of Zambia who are watching, and they are willing to jump in. So they have to be very, very careful. Now, getting back to, you know, President Lungu, do you think he is not really aware of the sentiments going on in Zambia? And, you know, do you think he doesn't really have enough information to make like a sound decision?
Yeah, you know what I'll tell you? From that statement that our president made on his tour, okay, he's got the information that he has is wrong. Like civil societies are funding us, you know, that we've got the information, civil societies are doing this and this and this and this. He's got wrong information. He needs to be in touch with the grassroots. Okay, now the people that are in touch, the people that are close to him and advising him, are not telling him the truth. And let me just say this: we have seen, like I've given examples downfalls of great leaders. I'll give an example of Zuma, Jacob Zuma. Jacob Zuma was being lied to. What happened to Jacob Zuma? He's in court alone. He's facing the courts of law alone. We looked at President Chiluba coming back to Zambia. Coming back to Zambia, President Chiluba, you know, what happened to President Chiluba? Mwanawasa fixed him. What happened to Rupia Banda? The people that were close to him that were telling him he was popular, he was great, he was all that. Look, the moment a leader loses a touch with the grassroots, becomes a problem. The moment the leader does not hear from the poorest person, it becomes a problem. Because those are the people that vote for you. Okay? So if you don't hear, look, leadership is about listening to the lowest person, not a person who's satisfied. Listen to a person that has no food at home. Listen to a person that's struggling to buy a bag of melamine. That is how you are going to know the problems. Leadership is about the roads. Let the president travel from Lusaka to Kawe on the road. Let him feel the roads. That's leadership. Experience what your people go through. That's how you're going to know the problems your people are facing. And because you're in the position of power, you can influence certain things. So it should be about politics of people and not politics of just power, power to myself. Because what is being exhibited right now is politics of power, is politics of saying, and you see also abusing scriptures. I saw Honorable Bowman Lusambo abusing scriptures on his Facebook page where he said, God puts systems, governments in place. Look, we cannot mock God. And for how long can the name of God be used in oppressing people? For how long will Christianity be used to oppress people? For how long shall we use religion to oppress people? You use religion when it's time for campaigns. You use religion when it best suits you. Do not forget that even the Bible says that whatsoever you do to the least of my brothers, that you do unto me. So when you oppress the least of that person, because Jesus came for the poor people, Michael Sata was a poor person who was speaking for the poor people. Okay, so if you don't listen to the poor people, the poorest of people in society, you are not supposed to be in that office. I would resign on moral grounds if the poorest of the poor people and people are not having meals and I'm having meals. Why should I be having meals as a leader and be enjoying all the benefits and yet people, can you even sleep, surely, knowing that there's so much hunger, there's so much poverty? Look, most of the commodities in our country have gone up, okay? If you look at mealie meal prices, how many families can afford a bag of mealie meal? How many families can afford a meal in a day, okay? I personally go in these compounds and I have started a country tour, you know, where I'm going in different provinces, in different districts. When you go in these places, you look at what people are eating. People have no food. People are not surviving. People are dying of hunger. We should be ashamed as a country that people can be dying of hunger in this day and age. Zambian population is only 18 million. 18 million. Can we fail to feed 18 million from the so much abundant resources that we have in this country? We are talking of gold. How much is gold? Surely, we have copper, these things. Why, if well managed, these resources, these natural resources can boost our economy and can, hunger could be the thing of the past in this country. We are not a big population. We can manage, this economy can be managed. There is no even need for Zambia to borrow money because we have so much resources. If you look at our tourism, how much can the tourism sector bring in this country? So much. How many? The problem is that we have not had the ministry has, you know, maybe has failed to really market this country. And I'll tell you for a fact, look at South Africa. South Africa markets that the Victoria Forces in South Africa is 1 hour flight from South Africa. They don't say that it's 1 hour, it's a flight to Zambia. No, 1 hour flight from South Africa, meaning that when you go to South Africa, you can land in South Africa if you're traveling from Europe and they get you on a plane to come to Zambia, but that money is being paid in South Africa. With the problem with us Zambians is that we've got the inferiority complex. Our politicians have done this. Our politicians have made us have this inferiority complex where we think that when you make money in Zambia, Zambia is only a country where you make money and you go and spend this money outside the country. That norm should change. We must be spending our money in Zambia. We must attract investment. We must attract tourists that will come and spend money in this country. Let me tell you this. If I were, for example, in the position of President Lungu, for example, okay, education sector is the tourism sector. You know that, right? The education sector can be the tourism sector. What do I mean? Invest in the University of Zambia. Invest in the University of Copperbelt University. Invest in more. Look, if we can have universities in every province, University of Zambia in every province, proper infrastructure. And now, look at this. You go and put, for example, a university in Kawambwa or Luapula province. Luapula province has got how many lakes? We've got Lake Mweruwantipa. We've got Lake Bangoulu. We've got how many falls in Luapula? We've got almost 8 or 10 falls. Kabweruma, Ntumbatushi, Mumburuma Falls, all these places are tourist attractions. So you set up universities in there. These people, you market. This university is in a place like this and this and this and this. These people will be traveling. Open up those places. Put up a proper airport. These people will be traveling in this country and flocking. We need to advertise our country. We need to prioritize Zambia. We need to put Zambia first. Because as long as we don't put Zambia first, this country will continue to lag behind. And our future generations will be thinking, I cannot only when I go out of Zambia. You see, even how many people go for holidays in Luapula province? How many people go for holidays, you know, within Zambia? You know, the trend that's there is that go to Dubai. Go to Dubai. We can have those the buildings that are in Dubai. What is the showgrounds doing? The showgrounds is only effective in August.
Yeah.
Okay. The showground is only effective in August. Go and work on the showgrounds. Shift the CBD remain there and be a place where people can do a vending. Okay. Shift the other things to this other side of town. All these are things we're talking about to say, if corruption is stopped,
yes,
all these things, we can have all these privileges once we fight corruption. And that's the reason why I took the route to fight corruption, because I realized to say, what is the root cause of our problems? The root cause of our problems is corruption. How does corruption begin? Corruption starts from a selfish individual who only wants to enjoy something alone. You understand? Okay. So you just want something for yourself and not thinking of the country. And that is why I'm saying the politics of power and not politics of people is what's causing our nation to always lag behind. I am well traveled. I am very well traveled. And it hurts me when I go to South Korea, South Africa, America, Europe. You see these countries doing very well. Now, you look at this. Zambia is one of the countries that built Europe. If we talk about London, because of our copper. Okay? We have the copper. We have the mineral resources. But the guys who've got the processing, who process it, are the ones who tell us how much we should sell it at.
Why doesn't do make any it? Sense.
It doesn't make sense.
Hello, Chellah, are you still there?
The person with the machine to process the mango juice to turn it into mango juice is the one who's telling you how much you'd be charging them. No, it doesn't make sense. We can borrow money. Okay, we are not saying that government should not borrow money. We can borrow money.
Hello, Chellah. Yeah, I kind of lost you there, but we're back. I can hear you now. Yeah, you can go on.
Okay. Yeah. So we can process these things. We've got Zambia has got in Mwilunga. We've got pineapple, right?
Right.
We've got pineapple. Okay. That pineapple. Why not go and put up a plant that side?
Mm-hmm.
And process that a pineapple, and we start exporting pineapple juice. Why should we be importing pineapple juice? Eastern province has got a, you know, is good for what's this groundnuts. Set up a peanut plant. Oil, peanut oil is used in massage. Peanut oil, you can use it for cooking. Peanut butter, you can, all these things, well-branded, proudly Zambian, can go a long way and can be exported. And we can now shift from being a consuming country into a country that exports, because we are just consuming. Products are coming from outside the country. Why? Because there's so much corruption, there's so much bribery going on. Those people just say, okay, look, we want to bring this in this country. We want to bring this in this country, and people who are corrupt, you know, they get a few bucks. Now, look, you get $2 million, okay, as kickback, as money for corruption, you know, to facilitate a deal for someone. You are being selfish. And why shouldn't we talk about you? Then when we question where you are getting the money, because you're in public office, we voted for you, then you start telling us that we should not challenge you. No. You know, we need to challenge you.
Exactly.
Because that is our money, you know. That is our money, you know. There's been so much that people have suggested in this country. Okay, look at, for example, marijuana being used as medicinal thing,
mm-hmm. you know,
all these things. But here you find in this country, because we use religion wrongly, we apply religion where it's not necessary.
Indeed.
Okay? We apply...
Chellah, are you there? The network is cutting. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay, yeah, now you're back. You're back. I can hear you.
You can hear me?
I'm loud and clear.
Yeah. So my thinking and my mission to start this thing that I started in terms of speaking out against corruption, speaking out against all these wrong things that are going on in our country, was because I felt Zambians are being robbed. Okay? That Zambians are being robbed. And you don't need to be in politics to speak about these things. And I'm not saying I'm becoming a politician. No, I'm just being a citizen who is looking at a bigger picture. And people must not misconstrue or miss a thing, you know, fit their minds and say, oh, Chellah now is becoming a politician. No, I don't need to be a politician to give advice to a politician. I don't need to be a politician for me to criticize a politician. I vote for those people. We vote for those people. We are entitled to question them.
Exactly.
We are entitled to ask, to say, look, if I can think like this, Why can't you think like that? Look, it's high time the Zambian population stop thinking of today and started thinking of tomorrow. It's
high exactly.
See, the problem I have with the youth of this country is the level of reasoning. You know, our Zambian youths, a majority of them, they just give them beers, you know, and you know, they give them beer, they give them 100 kwachas, and they start thinking that's the way life is supposed to be. No, my brothers and sisters, you are worth more than 100 kwacha.
Exactly.
More than that packet of chibuku. You are worth more than that chitenge. You are worth more than that t-shirt.
Right. Chellah, sorry for cutting you off. Just to add to that particular point, right? Like, let's say, for example, somebody decides to speak out and obviously stand out, right? A lot of Zambians have got that doubting eye saying, okay, why is he speaking out? Is it because he's being sponsored by this, that? Is it because he's being paid to do this? But here comes a person who just wants his country to be a better place. And he's obviously noticed and observed that because of corruption, we are lacking certain facilities. And when once you stand up and you speak out, people are just going to be saying, but why is he standing up now? So we need to really get rid of that particular mentality, because this is one of the reasons why Zambia is not really developing. And if we take a look at what has been happening, we've got a lot of resources. We've got gold, we've got diamonds, we've got oil, we've got crude oil. And every household in Zambia is even able to get about $1,000 from the government. But due to corruption, due to mismanagement of resources, we barely don't get anything. If each household in Zambia was to get about $1,000, that's like merely an $80 million per household. And that is very manageable to do, especially with our resources. Look at how much Mukule is going out in Zambia for. They are spending a lot of money. They are receiving a lot of money. If you talk about the gold, if you talk about the copper, which we have mismanaged, we could have been getting quite a lot of money just as citizens. But what usually happens is when, you know, like a political song comes, right? Yeah.
I want to give you one analysis, huh?
Yeah.
Like, for example, the purchase of this is the presidential jet and stuff, huh? There's very interesting stories behind it that about 1.692 million a billion, huh? Okay. Lost through corruption.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Now, divided by 18 million Zambians, that can give you a whopping 940 kwacha for every citizen.
Right.
There's another one which I calculated, the $10 million that, you know, lost through corruption. Now, here, that's $10 million, right?
Right.
Multiplied by how much? The dollar is at 18 kwacha. It gives us 180 million.
Kwacha. 180
million divided by 18 million Zambians, okay?
Yeah.
You're getting a whooping 100 kwacha every citizen. You understand?
Right.
Now, that is all money lost through corruption. And
right.
This money is only for a few people, you know, and not for all of us. So why should we sit back? Why should we not talk about these things? Because these things are affecting every one of us.
Exactly.
So I want my fellow Zambians to open up their eyes and see these things. You see, because things are bad.
Exactly. And Chellah, just to stick to that particular point, right? What can we do as Zambians and Zambian youths in order for these policies to be implemented? Because what I discovered is a lot of times during campaign season, right? a lot of politicians just end up giving out either bicycles or ifitenge. What we need to do is we need to be requesting for policies that better the lives of Zambians. And this is supposed to be done during the, or rather pre-campaign season. Right now, we're supposed to be highlighting and saying, okay, if you want our votes, you need to implement this and that policy. Not but for the ifitenge, but for the jinga and minimil.
Can I tell you what?
Yeah, sure, go on.
Politicians have mastered the art of doing politics in Africa or in Zambia, right?
Mm-hmm.
And what I mean by that, what they do now is less education. If you see the majority of people that vote, what is their level of education?
Yeah.
If we go back in time, I remember one of the old people who served in Chiluba's government. One of Chiluba's tactics to was not to have an educated a citizenry. Okay, I don't know how true that was, but this old man that served in his government said, "You know what? This man Kaunda was very intelligent because Kaunda wanted every Zambian to be educated." That was the thing. That's why there was free education during the time of Kaunda. And during the time of Chiluba, education now, you know, we started paying for education, there's all these things. If you have a population of uneducated people, it's very easy to manipulate them.
Exactly.
Now, majority of people that vote in our country lack basic education. Now, here you have a bunch of drunkards, okay, who just think, but I want to go, and I live vacant. Now, how sure are you that person is going to do that for you? It's time Zambians woke up and realize that it should not be campaigns of fake promises,
but yeah,
it should be campaigns that talk about everyone. Look, it starts with the people, for example, what I call the bootlicking system.
Yeah. Okay?
Where our voters, they want to appear good to the MP, what. And, you know, they are having this imaginary world to say, when he comes into power, this person will give us jobs at this ministry, at what, and other things, forgetting these procedures.
Yeah.
Now, we don't think of tomorrow, we think of today. We forget that there's a tomorrow. Look, one thing that Zambians needs to realize is this. When you vote, like next year,
yeah,
be ready to be to go through some more sufferings for another 5 years. Okay?
Yeah.
Next year, as we vote, I personally, I'm voting against infringement of human rights, personally. I'm voting against hunger. I'm voting against corruption. And that's the more reason why I'm not partisan. I'm waiting for a candidate that will come and speak strongly against cadarism, a candidate that will come and speak strongly against corruption, and how cases of corruption will be handled.
Right. Okay.
Let me give an example. We have two biggest political parties in Zambia, the Patriotic Front and the UPND.
Right.
They are always the parties that are fighting, panga for panga, an eye for an eye. That kind of politics we don't want. I want President HH to come out strongly and condemn violence and tell the cadres to say, when we win elections, I am not going to see any cadres in the markets. He needs to start telling us now to say, when I come into power, you cadres, my cadres, you should even know that when I come into power, there is no this nonsense.
True. Okay. True.
Otherwise, we are going just to change from green to red.
Exactly.
We are just going to change colors. We need these politicians who are in the opposition to start telling us to say, when a minister is caught in corruption, they are going to be dealt with immediately like this and this. Don't just come to us and say, Bali will do this, Bali will do that.
Yeah.
Okay. I am not pleased with the way things are going with the current government. I'm not pleased personally. And I wish that the president could fix some of these things and work on them when we started speaking up about them. But now we are seeing to say there is a problem somewhere. Now, what is the option? We don't have another option. When we look at the options that are there, the opposition, the language that the opposition has is scary.
Yeah. So
these are things that cause voter apathy.
Mm-hmm.
These are the things that cause voter apathy. Because the PF cadres will be scared to for UPND to win because they're scared to be beaten, to be treated like whatever, or to be treated. No. It should not be about politics or vengeance. This is the time that those in opposition should start showing unity and should start showing like they are ready to govern this country. You understand? These are the checks and balances that we as the youths and the baddest movement that have started have to do.
Right.
And balances. Don't just come to us and say, oh, Bali will do this. Let Bali fix those cadres who use pangas, those cadres who insult those people who have a different opinion. This country, we should debate politics of issues. It should be issue-based politics, not politics of when you say, I can't vote for this guy, then insults you are going to get are like, I don't know. The kind of youth that we have cannot debate issues.
That's true.
The youth, look, and the problem also is, it's not even about the politician.
Chellah, the line seems to be breaking.
Yeah, sorry. I don't know what's trying to call me. Sorry.
All right, yeah, but we can now hear you. So in the meantime, I just want to find out how can we make either the opposition or any political party that is going to get into, you know, leadership roles to implement these policies. Because by the end of the day, it's not really about saying that you're going to do something. You have to show the proof in terms of your manifesto, in terms of the policies. How are you going to implement that once you get elected? So how can we make sure that they stand by the policies they are preaching to us?
Look, this is the thing, okay? It's very easy to hold these people accountable,
mm-hmm.
right? When they are speaking, listen to them. Are they speaking because they just want the support from the youths? Because right now, opposition, obviously, they'll be thinking about, opposition leaders will be thinking, okay, uh-huh. Let's hello.
Yeah, I can hear you.
Yeah. So these guys are speaking like this. So let's tap into them and stuff like that. No. I'm not that person who's gonna be easily be bought to say, oh, okay, shall I come and support the NDC? Come and support FDD. Come and support UPND. Come and support PF. No. I am thinking critically. When you say you are going to create more employment for the youths, mm-hmm. the question is, how are you going to do it?
Mm-hmm.
Does the government have the capacity to employ all the youths? No. So you are merely giving us political rhetoric. That's political rhetoric of wanting to win numbers. You come to me and say, when I come into power, okay, we are going to raise $1 million, pump it into a CEEC, Citizens Economic Empowerment Commission, and Ministry of Youth Development. Okay, now this money will be accessed by all youths with brilliant plans, with brilliant business proposals. Then you are going to check on the interest rates. How are you going to, through Bank of Zambia, how are you going to reduce the interest rates? And how are you going to work on these guys when you borrow them money, when they borrow money or when they get money from the government?
How are you going to hold them accountable and make sure? So there has to be systems that now are going to help the young entrepreneurs who've got business ideas. For example, there are young people who are just looking for capital as low as 5,000 kwacha.
Exactly.
Okay. So do they need to go with the title deeds to get 5,000 kwacha? That's not supposed to be the case. A bank should be able, or a government should be able to give such amounts. Like, you have a, bring a business proposal. We have a look at it. You have a look at it. CEC, Citizens Economic Empowerment Commission, look at this document. But the ministers, hold these people accountable. And when you look, and it doesn't look, one of the things that people say is that, how are they going to be able to pay back and all those things? Look, there's always a way that these people can do it.
Yeah.
Okay. You also factor in the risk. That's where these companies that do risk management come in. This is what we call risk management. Okay. So empower your citizens with capital. Let every citizen own a business and have extra income. Because people's salaries are stressed. You understand?
Yeah, right.
People say getting 3,000 kwacha, 3,500 kwacha, 5,000 kwacha. From that money, they have to pay rentals. From that money, they have to pay, they have to buy food. From that money, they have, no. So what you do is you help the citizens have multiple sources of income. How do you do that? You make the environment conducive. As we speak, the environment is not conducive. Now, This is the thing. When a president becomes a president, he's no longer a party property. That president is a public property. He's a property of the nation. That president, whether this person voted for them or did not vote for them, they have to embrace those people. Okay?
Right.
Proposal. Are these, when this thing of, for example, Qatarism,
okay,
how can we stop Qatarism? We can stop Qatarism. We've been fighting with Qatarism and political violence for a long time. Let the state, through the DPP and the Attorney General, be able to sue a political party that is violent. The moment they start suing the political parties because they are being violent, believe you me, all those secretary generals, the secretary general of the party, the leadership of the party will go to court, and there has to be an amount of money. You have to charge that political party.
Right.
Lots and lots of money. You understand? So you see, every political party caught wanting in political violence, you are going to pay 100,000 kwacha fine. What will happen is that the political parties will strengthen their constitution. The political parties will take stock of the people that belong to that political party. Okay? So, what will happen is that if you are found in political violence as a cadre, the party will say, no, let's investigate. Is this person our member? Yes. If this person is our member, then you understand. So these are some of the proposals that we want to hear from the opposition. Not just thinking to say, if I shout at the cadres, they will not vote for me. The politics, you see, these cadres have taken, they've taken control of our lives because they feel empowered, they feel entitled to say, I campaigned, so I'm entitled to get money because I campaigned. Look, you campaigned, yes, but who voted? Millions of people voted. So don't just think of the person that campaigned for you. Think about the voters too. The problem comes in, you think of the campaigners and not the campaign managers, the campaigners and whatever you call them, and not the people. The biggest people, the biggest employers are the people that vote for you. So to curb political violence, come down to that. And also make sure that the police, the civil servants, are well empowered. While fighting against corruption, we'll make sure that the fight against corruption will bring more resources, more money into the coffers of the country. Now, when you fight against corruption, you what you're doing is that you're instilling confidence in the investors. You instill in confidence in the investors, and there'll be a lot of investors coming in the country. You don't, if you have a brilliant proposal, you can go and see the president without corrupt bribing someone.
True.
So that will automatically start having more money in circulation. The dollar will start going down. The dollar will start dropping on its own. You understand? Because there's that confidence in the economy. People are, you know, people are not holding on to money. You understand? They feel secure. So the moment you fight corruption, zero tolerance to corruption, zero tolerance to cadrerism, all these things that cause insecurities, believe you me, this country can be a great, great country. Zambia is rich. What we are lacking is leadership that focuses on the people. That is the leadership we are lacking. We have leadership that focuses on the cadres that campaign and themselves, and not leadership that's focusing on the people.
True.
Millions of dollars that are being lost. Get $5 million, for example, that I gave an example of Amos Chan that got from AVIC International. Get $5 million. Invest it in UTH. Tell me how UTH will be like. Let's talk of $5 million.
That's mm-hmm. a lot of money. A lot.
That's a lot of money. Get that $5 million, invest it in the education sector without corruption, without, and every note, every cent accounted for.
Exactly.
This country would not even have a situation where we should be ashamed of ourselves as a country, that we have places where there are no desks in this country, where children are sitting on the floor. We should be ashamed, you know, we should be ashamed. And as a nation that, and as the people that vote, we should also be questioning our caliber. What kind of people are we?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, what kind of people are we, you know? We should be a people that, you know, hold our leaders accountable. And yeah, so I don't know any other questions.
All right. Okay. So good afternoon, good morning, good evening, depending on where you're watching us from. We are Zed Corner, and I am kindly asking all our viewers right now to share this video, because Chellah Tukuta is just getting started. We are going to unveil everything, because the Zambian people deserve the truth. So I just want you to take this humble opportunity to share this video on all your pages, start watch parties, put it in all the different groups, and let's get the information out there. Now, Chellah, getting back to our earlier conversation with regards to using Christianity, because what has been happening in the past few years, right? We obviously saw this from Chiluba. He was talking about Zambia being a Christian nation and always, putting Christianity out there. But the things that he was doing behind the back, that was so unchristian-like. So do you think a lot of politicians use Christianity to sort of put a blindfold on the citizens?
Look, I'll start with this. Christianity and the peace, has actually cost Zambia a lot.
True.
Here is the thing. Zambians cannot have peaceful protest, okay? Because if you have a peaceful protest, you are viewed as someone who's trying to bring anarchy. What is dangerous about a peaceful walk? People just carrying placards with messages. Okay?
Yeah.
So we thought, you know, Zambia has enjoyed peace for the past 50 years, 55 years. We cannot afford, we are not saying that we are breaking the law by starting vandalizing. People are just walking. Okay? And The other thing is Christianity. When we and actually our pastors are problems. Christianity is not a bad religion. It's just that it's been used as a tool to attend to power. This one is labeled Satanist. This one is labeled Christian. This one is labeled humble. This one is labeled arrogant. This one is labeled a thief. This one is labeled that. Those are things that have cost this nation. And they use the name of Christianity and the church. And our pastors who are corrupt, most of them eat the money. There are pastors who go and collect money from these politicians and they come up with Christians for Chellah Tukuta. So when you say Christians for Chellah Tukuta, what are you saying about the other person? What are you saying about the people that support the other person? We need to change that mentality. Christianity, look, we are Christians, but let's use our brains.
Yes.
Think. Because, look, our faith, okay, we are not saying that we should not be Christians, no. I'm Christian. But the way we apply our Christianity is a sad reality. Okay? Because we don't know even where to apply Christianity.
Right.
Here's the thing. People steal money. They steal money, steal money, steal money, steal money, steal money. They call you, let's go and pray.
Mm-hmm.
You know? they call you, let's go and pray. They call you, let's have prayers over this. Look, it's not all problems require spiritual solutions. No. Zambian problems do not require spiritual solutions. Zambian problems require leadership solutions. What kind of leaders do we entrust power with? What kind of leaders do we put on the throne? What kind of people are leading us? You look at an example of our minister, Mr. Lusambo,
mm-hmm.
who threatened his citizens in Lusaka.
Yes, yes. It
shall not happen in Lusaka province. Okay? That is the leadership we are talking about. Now, are we going to blame Honorable Lusambo? No. We have to blame ourselves.
Right.
Right.
Okay, because we are the voters. So we should sit down and look at it and say, okay, so these are the people that we have in office. Okay. So when the time comes to vote, vote wisely. You've got a voter's card. Apply your wisdom. Apply your knowledge when you're voting. Which candidate is speaking sense and which candidate, a meanwhile for the country. To lead a country properly, you don't need, and I'll be very clear on this one. To lead a country, you need wisdom, not religion.
Exactly.
To lead a nation, you need wisdom and not religion. Religion does, being called a Christian does not make you a Christian. Calling yourself a Christian does not make you a Christian. What makes you a Christian is your acts, the things you do. Do you follow the example of Jesus? When Jesus, our president is a Christian, if it was Jesus, would he say, those chaps criticizing me, disrespecting me, Campion Goswa, would he?
No.
No.
So, a lot of us look at wrong things in a person. And I'll tell you what, it's like people say, you were a womanizer. You're talking about the youth today, you know? And they're like, how has that got to do with speaking for the people?
Absolutely nothing.
It has nothing to do with that. You understand? But what I'm trying to say is that wisdom precedes anything else. So we need to be a country that questions that, you know, investigates, checks these leaders. Do they mean well for our country?
Right.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay, so anyway, just to add to that particular point, right? Obviously, this is one of the things that Africans barely know, but slavery and colonialism started with Christianity, because the foreigners, they came to the land with a Bible and a whip. Okay, so if you closely saw what Bowman Lusambo was doing, right, after saying all these things about the people who are trying to voice out for the people, right, he goes back to quote the word of God. Okay, so sometimes we're not saying Christianity is a bad thing. I am a Christian, we are Christians, but we have to be very vigilant as Zambians, because they are using this ideology of Christianity to steal from us, to continue corruption, to mismanage the wealth, because they know that Zambians are going to turn, you know, a blind eye, or they're going to, you know, move their cheek and let us slap them on the other side. So we just have to be vigilant. We have to call for accountability, and we have to make sure that everything is done properly. Not just because somebody quotes a Bible verse, or somebody brings, you know, like a prayer's day, or then we're supposed to let them go scot-free with whatever injustices they are doing.
Look, it's not in the declarations. It's in the acts.
Exactly.
It's not in the declaration. You can declare something, yet you don't even believe in it. You know, for the sake of winning elections, I can say we are going to have 3rd May as National Day of, you know, Bible. Everyone has to just be reading the Bible. Yet I don't even believe in the same Bible that I'm talking about. But because in a country where I am, it's a Christian nation. And that country, because it's a Christian nation, I know to say the moment I affiliate myself with Christianity, I'm going to win elections. That rhetoric should change. That rhetoric should change. We should not just be a people that think, okay, because I've mentioned the name of Jesus, then I'm qualified to be a leader. No. The fact that I'm calling upon the name of God, no. Guys, actually, Christianity should be able to transform us. We should be Christians first, real Christians first, before we think of leadership. Not because we have to be Christians because we want to be leaders or want to be in positions of power. Look, I believe in leaders that are Christians first before they are leaders, and not people who are, because they are ascending to leadership, so then they become Christians. Because majority people are Christians. No. Okay. Here you have a person who was quoting a scripture today, and yet he was beat up Major Richard Kachingwe.
Yeah. On record, there's evidence, actual footage.
Exactly. Now, the thing is this, that's what we call hypocrisy. That's being hypocritical. I personally, as Chellah, cannot go and condemn someone to say, you know, I was making money, let's say, through sleeping around. Then I go and condemn someone to say, hey, stop to that. No. Unless I've really changed, I've stopped that behavior, then I can say, you know what? I think that kind of behavior is not good, because it yielded this and this and this and this in my life. So we should be, when we are ascending, when we are aspiring to positions of power, we must have, we must be people that do a thorough check within ourselves. Okay.
Right.
So that we inspire the next generation. Because to be honest with you, I'm not inspired by the Honorable Sambo. I'm not inspired at all. I'm not inspired. He's not right. Someone I can look up to. No.
Right. And
leaders that you can look up to. Because right now, Zambia is in a leadership crisis. We have a leadership crisis. And that crisis, I don't know, because you have the educated people who are, but they are scared of being in politics. You see, the thing is this. Politics is not supposed to be a dirty game, okay? This is the more reason why people feel like, if I aspire to political thing, people start thinking that you are there to loot money, to make money. No, politics should be an opportunity to serve and make your country better.
True.
Improve the lives of people. That's what politics is supposed to be. Politics is not supposed to be a dirty game of violence, a dirty game of insults. Those insults, insulting each other, won't solve anything. The insults won't put food on the table of the millions of Zambians that are suffering. What you need as a party or as a leader is to serve those people. You understand? Is to be for the people. Is to see that the lives of the people that are voting for you are improved. Even when you have a thought of aspiring for leadership or for MP or for president or for local government, you need to clear your intentions and your thoughts to say, I'm going there to save the people. And this is the movement that I want to move in this country, to say our young future generations should know that when you aspire to political power, is not to go and loot and make yourself rich, make yourself more powerful. No. Don't forget, power belongs to the people. They are the voters. So our future generations should know to say, when I aspire to power, I'm going to work for the people, not for myself. But what we have now is even people now, someone can just wake up, have hidden agendas, and lie. That's why they lie. There is too many lies in politics. And that's why the name of politics has been dented, because politics is not supposed to be bad. But the name has been dented because of the people that we put in those positions.
Right, right. And Chellah, I've got a question in terms of, one of our viewers. So if you've got any questions, please drop them in the comment section below. Mercy, who happens to be watching us, has got a question in terms of recycled leaders or politicians. What is your suggestion in terms of preventing the same people getting into power? Because we are having situations where somebody who used to be in UNIP is in MMD, this same person is also in PF. Like, what are we doing recycling the same people if we are changing one system to the other? So how can we prevent recycled leaders who have proven to be incompetent, who have proven not to produce results? Why are they being re-elected into managing positions?
You know what I'll tell you? These people who are the recycled politicians have come up with the notion to say, youths are leaders of tomorrow. And the young people are scared to, let's say, for example, you, okay? If right. You said, you want to stand as an MP, the same youths will start saying, Abanavina, just because he is admin for Z Corner or he owns this page, now he feels like he should. No, that is the problem. Okay. If Chellah said, okay, I'm going to stand as what, then people start saying, you see, you understand that mentality. It comes down to the mentality of people. If someone, people are not comfortable with the right people aspiring for power, for positions of power, a person with the right intentions will not be liked. You need to come with lies. I will give you free internet. Yes. I will Disneyland. Yes. I'll be giving you a bag of meal every day. Yes. I'll be giving you salt and tomato and beer. Yes. We look, the things we look at is the things that look. I think even in this country, we need the electoral college, or we need a place where people, the voters are educated. Okay. those who have the opportunity of leading this country, create places in schools. Let children start learning about how to elect leaders when they are in grade 5.
Mm-hmm.
Grade 5 going up. Talk about in civic education, start teaching children in terms of politics. We should change our syllabus. Our syllabus is where the problem is. The education system has failed us.
Cha-ching.
Our education system has failed us. We always think that, okay, old is gold. You understand? The same recycled politicians use those terms, old is God. Yes, we agree. We totally agree. But when will the youths lead this country? We had the people like Venon Mwanga, okay? Venon Mwanga, who was an MP or in parliament at a very tender age, okay? The likes of the Michael Chilusha Satas and all these things, and all these people. Now, today, youths are scared to take up those challenges, okay? You understand?
Yes.
We are even scared to say, okay, some young people, I'll give you this example. This young person told me, Mr. Chellah, me, I want to stand as an MP in Luansha, where I come from. I said, yeah, no problem. But, he said, but what people are telling me, it's discouraging. You see?
Mm-hmm.
This young person has got a passion to serve. But you at home, you the friends are telling MP. Yeah, you can't be okay. You bring your intentions to social media to say, oh, I'm going to stand as an MP in Chamboli or whatever it is. Politics, that's why we've gotten it wrong.
Right,
that's
right.
The reason why the liars, politics has attracted the liars, thieves, thugs. It has attracted those people because those are the ones who are courageous. Those are the ones who are courageous. We don't even, you'll find someone doesn't even have a grade 12 certificate. Yeah?
True.
He doesn't even have the right qualifications, but is he serving as a minister, as a PS? No proper qualifications.
Yeah, that's very true.
And also, we are not saying that you need a degree to be a leader. In my opinion, a grade 12 certificate is enough as long as someone is wise and has a vision. You need to have a vision. You need to understand people because you see it's people politics, you understand people. Okay, and apply wisdom. That's what I know. So
So Chellah, talking about the grassroots, right? Obviously, in Bemba, they usually say "imiti kula empanga." So, if we talk about our education structure, right? Let's say starting from primary school, we need to have a spirit where the young people are engaging in developmental issues. If we talk about the University of Zambia, right now we are supposed to be seeing a lot of university, sort of organizations come out and talk about relevant issues. Where are the students? What policies do they want to, have the government implement? How vocal should they be? So we need to start organizing everything from the grassroots.
You know what I would propose? Like I said, education should be for all. Okay? Education should be accessed by everyone. Okay? Everyone should be entitled to education. Okay? Give the people, the basic need you can give the people is education. educate your population and you will see how developed you'll be as a country. Let me give you a very good example of South Korea. Okay. South Korea was going, the government was using what we call JETS, and these are projects in schools. These science projects in schools where kids come up with projects and, you know, come up with a plan and what, and they look into the minds of these chaps, okay, and see, okay, so this chap is able to think like this. So now, instead of wasting their time teaching them 20 subjects in school, you've identified their talent worst at grade three. First things first, expose them to everything. The early learning centers should expose kids to everything and should let the kids be. You see, as kids, we like to explore.
Right.
Let the kids explore, and identify their strengths in them. So you find this child is good at making shoes. Then you look at it and you're like, okay, this child has got, knowledge about shoes. Help that child harness and nurture that talent properly. Now, take them to a place where they manufacture shoes. Teach them about whatever it is, cooked rubber, what leather, what all those things, materials, how to what from that tender age. That child can grow up to be a manufacturer of shoes. Invest in them. Set up a plant that manufactures shoes. Why should we have companies from outside Zambia coming to manufacture shoes? Why should we have, is Bata a Zambian company?
No. No, it's not. I believe so.
No, it's not. Okay. So these are things that we need to think big. We need to restructure the education system, like I said. Make it accessible to everyone. Open more research centers. We need the malls, yes, we are not refusing. But look, you put up a proper mall at this park. Kwa proper mall, pa. But look at the spaces that are there between these malls. You just walk a small distance, there is a mall. Another, there is a mall. There is a mall. These China malls are all over even now.
Right.
Okay. Now, why not invest in the education system, in the education sector, by having more research centers where people research, where people spend more time researching. Create an environment, a competitive environment. Ministry of Education should come up with prizes, okay? Come up with prizes to say the one who's going to have this project, who's going to do this, their best project, they win a scholarship to what, they'll get so much, they'll do this, they'll get all those things. Once that is done, we'll have competition in this country, and this country will be a great country. We need new thinking. We need to think in the 21st century. We are not in the Kaunda days of manual things. No. We are in a computerized generation. We need leaders that understand modern technology. Modern technology. Look, in this day and age, we should be ashamed that where you go, Wi-Fi is a very difficult thing to find. No, you should have Wi-Fi almost everywhere.
Indeed.
You should access internet almost everywhere. You know, it should not be a problem for someone to buy a smartphone. We are in a time where technology is at our fingertips. We should be in a time where, look, not that I'm aspiring for presidency, yeah? But let me give you an example. Proper leadership. Let's say, for example, I'm president. Right. And I'm not saying people should
Yeah, I'm just giving an example. People should not take this noise as aspiring for. No, no, no. I'm president of the country. Okay. I should be able to have technology that has that helps Zambians in the diaspora to vote.
Indeed.
Why should Zambians in the diaspora travel all the way from?
Chellah, you are breaking. I don't know whether you can still hear me. Are you as there?
Hello?
Okay, now you're back. You can go on.
Yeah. As long as you're Zambian, you should be able to vote from anywhere. As long as you're Zambian. Okay, am I back?
Yes, you are back. Okay, Chellah.
Okay.
Okay, well, you can finish your point before I ask you one more question.
Yeah, so you can be in Congo, you can be anywhere, you can vote, okay? Then two, you are president of this country, okay? Zambian problems can only be dealt by Zambians themselves. The economy of this country has to be managed by Zambians, because they understand, okay, their currency, they understand everything that's around Zambia. So don't let foreigners come and manage the economy. Yes, foreigners can come as investors, but they should listen to us and what we need. Foreigners should not come and say, okay, we want to put a mall here. Here is $200,000. No. When foreigners come, they should ask us. They should give us, let's say, for example, a president. They should come with proper drawings. You come and check. Okay, you want to come and bring investment? Okay. When you see a building, you're going to put up a mall. Can we have a look at the mall that you're going to put up? Okay. Are you telling me that Zambia cannot have the Sandton City Mall?
We can.
Are you telling me that Zambia cannot have those skyscrapers that are there? Are you telling me that the CBD, Cairo Road, cannot have modern buildings? It can have. It's all about policies. It's about deliberate decisions, deliberate policies. You put Zambia first and you see how CBD can change there. It's a one thing. Just we are going to focus. We are going to focus on building this. Engineers from University of Zambia, Zambian engineers that are qualified Zambian engineers who have studied abroad, who have come on board. Come, we want to restructure town. We want to restructure CBD.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, you guys go to Chinsali. Okay, these, for example, provincial headquarters. Go to Ndola, go and make a study, come up with how we can develop this, because right now we are living under the same plans, the town plans that they had. Who plans our cities?
Exactly.
So these are some of the things that we need to open our minds to and see, to say we need to have a paradigm shift in the political sphere, how we look at politics. And the voter should be able to think and critically analyze, what am I voting for? Why am I voting for that person?
Mkwaye. And just to add to that particular point, right? We as Zambians, just like you said, we need a paradigm shift. We need to change our mentality. And most importantly, we also need to change our work ethics. Because by the end of the day, these contracts are being given to foreigners because, one, in Zambia, we've got a notion saying, "Gana pero mu Zambian, this Zambian is not competent enough to carry out a certain task." So this is why, as the Zambian youths, we need to be showcasing our prowess. We need to show that we are capable of doing certain things and achieving.
I can argue with you on that point.
Mm-hmm.
Zambians are hard workers.
Indeed.
It's what you give them. It's, you see, Zambians get frustrated easily. Yeah? The only way you can motivate a Zambian, one, first things first, give them proper conditions of service. Give them incentives. Look, Zambians are not bad people. I'll be honest with you. Zambians are very intelligent people and very good.
Exactly, very intelligent. Trust me.
I'll tell you that very fast. Look, you know why Zambians drink? Or more why the people go and out and drink? Frustrations, what. Do this. Tell a secretary to say, you have to report for work at 6:30. Your salary is 6,000 kwacha. This. You have all this. You're entitled to get a loan, buy yourself a car. This. You're able to get this. You're entitled to free airtime. You're entitled to this. You're entitled to that. Mm-hmm. You know what you're doing? You're motivating that way.
Yes.
Motivate the worker. Motivate yes. The Zambian worker. And the Zambian worker will prove to you that they are good.
Right.
If the Zambian worker is not motivated, it becomes a problem. The youths have got so much energy. The young people.
A lot.
So much energy. These young people, just don't tell them to say, hey, don't go to bars. Don't go and drink. No, that's rough. These young people, what you do is this. Give them something to do. They'll automatically stop going to the bars because they have something to do.
Right.
Our mentality is not as bad. It's the kind of politics that we've been through that has changed that mentality.
Right.
And people think, I need to be connected to a politician. We need to inculcate a culture where you feel like you don't have to be a cadre, because now we have even doctors becoming cadres. We have lawyers becoming cadres, professionals becoming cadres, because that's the only way to survive. Now, let professionals be professionals. Let the nurses, bring the nurses from those nurses in Zambia. Improve the conditions of service in this country for nurses. Improve the conditions of service for teachers. Improve the conditions of service for the civil servants. You will see how this country will change drastically one time.
True. And
also, when you go into the system as a president, listen to the people that have been in the system. They will advise you, they will tell you, this can change this. But also, you need to have a vision of yourself.
Mm-hmm.
I need to change this year. I need to change this year. I need to change that year. Then you change those things. So, in my opinion, this country is rich. This country can be a great nation. What we are lacking is leadership, period.
Indeed. And Chellah, I want to touch a very important topic, because, you know, by the end of the day, regardless of how we talk about things, yeah, it really depends on personal motivation. And sometimes we as youths need to have our own hustles. Like, for example, doing what you're doing right now, not a lot of Zambians are able to stand up, because one, if they stand up, their source of income is going to be taken away from them. So we need to have some sort of hustle mentality and just find ways to be able to self-sustain ourselves. Because right now you've got other sources of income. So this is why you can go against the government. You can speak out. You can stand your ground. Because by the end of the day, you know that my source of income is not really going to be affected. So my question is, how can we promote the spirit of hustling, the spirit of having different sources of income?
You know, I'll be honest with you. It's not about speaking out because you've got another source of income and stuff like that. You see, it's the issue of sacrifice.
Mm-hmm.
I believe in sacrificing and in speaking out. Now, the fact is that we are not risk takers.
Yes.
And unfortunately, success is for risk takers. In life, you need to take risks. Okay. And you don't have to speak out because you've got multiple sources of income. So this will not happen. No, I'm a photographer. I deal with individuals. Okay. I deal with companies as well and stuff like that. But for me, what I think is that we should be more patriotic to our country. Patriotism to your nation and to your country. Look, and this is what I dream of. This is the Zambia I dream of, where whichever position you are given to serve in the country, you swear before the Zambian people to serve with integrity. Whether you are going to be an accountant in Shan, you swear. You understand?
Yes.
At the ministry, you swear. And also, as a nation, look, you cannot have multiple sources of income in this country today because all the connections, you need to be a card. That is the problem. And it's either you're doing business that's dealing directly with people or doing business that's dealing with the government. The moment you deal with the government and you're not... You disagree with the president, with the leadership, it means that your business is cut off.
Yes.
No, it should not be the case. We should change that.
Exactly. And that's why a lot of Zambian youths are afraid to speak up, because they are having this notion saying, okay, even though I'm seeing that what they're doing is a bad thing, if I say something, I'm either going to end up being locked up, or I'm going to lose the source of income that I have. So by the end of the day, we are being doing injustice to ourselves, because we are throwing more fire to that fuel. You know, throwing fuel to that fire. So what we need to do is, regardless, you just have to do it, because by the end of the day, if you keep quiet, the situation is not going to improve. If you talk, the situation might improve. So you are doomed if you do or you do not. So the best thing that you can do is speak out and hope for the best, and obviously get to change the narrative. Because by the end of the day, if you continue being silent, it's even going to get worse. The little source of income that you have is even going to be little by the end of the day, because you are not speaking out. So regardless of your position, your situation, you are supposed to be patriotic to the land of Zambia, because it really depends on you. So it doesn't really matter. Please do not be afraid to speak out and just stand for justice and what's correct.
True.
Right, so I think we've had a very good discussion today. Yeah. And do you have any last remarks before we conclude today's live stream?
Yeah, my last remarks young people should not be scared to challenge the status quo. It's now or never. Okay, and when you see a young person wanting to stand as an MP, as a councillor, or for presidents, support them. Don't start saying, "Mwena imoya lost." No. Create your own freedom fighters of your own generation. Create your own president. Create your own minister. Now. It's now or never. Stop being scared to say, "Oh, for me to speak out, I need to have money to be bailed out." No. If the truth takes you to prison, the same truth will take you out of prison.
True.
If injustice takes you to prison, justice will take you out of prison. We should not be selfish and think, for me to speak only for the people. I could have been selfish and not start speaking out against all these bad things happening in our country. I could have just been quiet and eat my money in peace. But someone will come and tell me, "Just go and do your photography." No. Those are selfish people not looking at the bigger picture. The bigger picture is that all Zambians should have equal opportunities, and we must love each other
young people need to question their leaders. My motto in life, aspire to leadership because you want to serve the people and not for selfish gain.
True. Chellah, are you there? We're kind of losing you.
Politics that discuss development, politics that discuss, you know, how we are going to improve the lives of people, and not just politics that discusses, when I win, I'm going to fix that one. When I become president, this one, it should not be a witch hunt. We should do politics that puts the interest of Zambia and the interest of Zambians first. Let us unite. We are not against the government. No. And we are not inciting any violence. No. We only want to question, why is there hunger? Why is this happening in our country? What have we done? We need to change. We need to change our mentality. We need to change the conversations we have on social media and start discussing, what kind of Zambia do I want to see tomorrow? What kind of arguments are we having on social media? Let's change that. Let's have a situation where Zambian musicians can be buying mansions, cars. Let's have Zambians go and walk in the showroom and buy a brand new car. And not because you have to be, unless you're a politician, unless you're a permanent secretary. Look, empower your citizens and make them great, and the economy will be the best economy. Thank you very much.
Indeed, and I just remembered one thing. On the 22nd of June 2020, there's going to be a peaceful gathering at the Parliament's ground. I'm sure you have heard about this gathering. So I hope you're going to attend, or you're going to give us your blessings, because now we want to take action. So everybody watching this live stream right now, mark it on your calendar, 22nd June, from around 12 hours to about 14 hours. We are going to be at Parliament grounds, and we're just going to be asking our leaders to, you know, give us some answers, because we've got a lot of questions in terms of corruption, in terms of mismanagement of our resources. So this time it's all about action. So please mark that on your calendar. Chellah, thank you very much for gracing us with your presence. I really learned a lot, and I just want to tell all the Zambians out there that Chellah Muntu Wesu, if he is being silenced, it means everybody else is being silenced. Tomorrow is going to be you. Tomorrow is going to be your cousin, your daughter. So we have to protect and monitor what's happening with Chellah, so that we make sure that nothing happens to our brother, and he's going to be, you know, safe. So thank you very much for joining this exciting episode of, you know, High Level Talk here on Z Corner. Follow us, hit the like button, and, you know, share this video as well, because everybody deserves the truth. Thank you very much. Once more, Chellah, have a great day. Be blessed, my brother.
Thank you, and same.